chip.
Gibson, swing.
This is going to be a home run. Unbelievable.
I don't believe what I just saw.
He was to Iowa what Red Grange was to Illinois, something like a god. As a football player, the Corn Belt Comet was a Heisman Trophy winner, named to the Sports Illustrated All-Century team 60 years after his last game. But he did much more than play football. By some magical mix of qualities listed in every Boy Scout manual, he raised the expectations of a generation of Iowans yearning to reach the other side of the Great Depression. He did it by teaching them how to win, how to fight, and how to die. Here is the story of Nile Kinnick, a Middle America hero.
This was 1939, and the country had been depressed economically for 10 years. And the Farm Bill especially was in bad shape.
And one of the things that happened was a wholesale closing of banks, and some people lost all their money. The banks went from 1,900 banks in 1920 to around 500 banks by 1935. Between 1926 and 1931, there were 25,000 farms went through mortgage foreclosure in Iowa.
On top of that, Iowa and the rest of the Midwest is hit by a terrible drought, which really complicated the recovery from the Depression. It was a very bleak time all over Iowa.
If Iowa was still in the throes of the Depression in 1939, there were signs elsewhere that better times lay ahead. At the New York World's Fair, the Trilon and the Perisphere acted as dynamic symbols of the future. But by Labor Day, war clouds gathered across the nation.
September 1st, football season, shall we say, that was when Hitler invaded Poland. Britain and France declared war on Germany. It was one of the United States and the free world's worst crises.
1939 was a great year, but it was also a troubled year. Nile Kinnick was somebody that took our minds off of that.
They had to find something to identify with that was good, that was wholesome, that was positive. Nile Kinnick gave all Iowans hope.
You could have a hometown boy like that that had that grit, that determination, straight A student, all around, good person, good values, give you a lot of pride. I think all of that holds a lot of sway over the imagination and the minds of people like me from the state of Iowa.
He was a meteor in a time when Iowa was at abysmal low in athletics, and he was a nova that lit up the sky.
In Kinnick's first two seasons, Iowa won only two of 16 games. Then in 1939, Eddie Anderson's squad of overachievers, known as the Iron Men, shocked the football world as Kinnick ignited a series of fourth quarter rallies.
When the chips were down, when they needed a play, Nile Kinnick made it.
I saw him beat Notre Dame and the Minnesota Gophers on successive weekends. He did it almost entirely by himself.
Against number two ranked Notre Dame, Kinnick averaged 46 yards on 16 punts. The following week, his seven completions were good for 157 yards and two fourth quarter touchdowns as Iowa upset perennial power Minnesota 13-9.
The whole state seemed to be uplifted by this team. My father thought that Nile was one of the finest young men that he'd ever met. I mean, every kid wanted to have 24 on his jersey.
In 1939, Joe DiMaggio led the Yankees to a championship with an MVP season. And Joe Louis knocked out four opponents. But it was Kinnick, the Heisman Trophy winner, who was named the AP's Athlete of the Year. He played every minute of six consecutive games, accounting for 107 of Iowa's 130 points for the season.
We saw the way this guy worked, and we tried to emulate what he did. He was the motivation, and he did it with such humility. There was truly a love on the part of his teammates.
I only met him once at the stadium. And basically, to a kid like me, it'd be like meeting Babe Ruth. I remembered it to this day, and I'm 74, so it must have had some kind of an impact.
couple of times I was walking downtown with one or two friends of mine, and Nile was walking along, and he'd say, "Hi, Jerry." Well, I mean, I was just in seventh heaven.
Nile kind of was the centerpiece of the pep rallies. He was our speech maker. I've never seen him more eloquent and more relaxed.
He was very aware of who he was, and I think he handled it quite well.
Right after the 39 season, there was signs up on cars and all over the place, billboards, Nile for governor.
Politics had always stirred in Kinnick's blood. His grandfather served two terms as Iowa's governor.
I think people just admired the young man so much that I doubt that he recognized how much he was admired. He just captured the imagination of this state like nobody ever has since.
The public reaction was typical of the way the public reacts to anyone who comes out of nowhere and succeeds quickly.
He was an idol. He was a great person, not just a football player. And that's the reason the people from Iowa loved him.
I think he was destined to be governor or senator or even higher. He had the ability, he had the smarts, and he had the drive to do it.
But like all young men of his time, Nile Kinnick was soon confronted with a world at war and a very different future from the grand design that seemed to lie ahead.
Is your dandruff sending the wrong signals? Get Selsun Power. Doctors recommend Selsun Blue. So don't send the wrong signals. Get Selsun Power.
Daughter Mob Hits. Have your credit card ready and call 1-800-965-3700. Or send check or money order for $22.95 for two CDs or $19.95 for two cassettes plus $4.95 shipping to the address on your screen. Rush delivery available. Call now.
He was getting ready to go into Chicago to play in the All-Star game against Green Bay. The football players told him, says, son, if you can possibly make a living any other way than playing pro football, be sure and take it up.
When Kinnick turned down a $10,000 offer from the NFL's Brooklyn Dodgers, the class president and Phi Beta Kappa had more than a premonition of what awaited him and his classmates after graduation in 1940.
We must learn to face adversity with equanimity, and even philosophically, but at the same time, never for a moment losing sight of the ultimate goal, never failing in our ambition or our ideals. By now, we should realize that the battle is life itself, and that our joy and happiness should lie as much in the struggle to overcome as in the fruition of a latter day.
What he wanted for himself doesn't get mentioned as much as what he wanted for the public.
Despite Kinnick's acute mind, high ideals, and varied accomplishments, he could not decide on his own future.
Dear Mother, sometimes I wonder if I'm not just one of these nice guys whom the parents like and wish their children would emulate, but doesn't seem to have much idea how to make a living.
I've never met anyone who had their life as well programmed out as Nile did, and he was programmed so that every hour of every day, he didn't let him slip. I was a little surprised at some of the indecision that he had.
I think that's a function of simply being alive and aware, broadly aware. Kinnick often had more than one opportunity at the same time. Well, the question was which one to pick. He realized that he must prepare for the long haul. And going to law school, that was a positive decision.
Kinnick returned to Iowa City in the fall as a freshman law student and assistant football coach. He gained a reputation as one of the best speakers in the state. During the 1940 presidential race, he introduced Wendell Willkie, Franklin Roosevelt's Republican challenger, at a rally of 10,000.
That was one of the finest introductory speeches I've ever listened to. It was short, it was a classic. And I remember saying, since I knew the history of the family, that this guy's gonna be governor sometime.
He told me afterwards that Wilkie really did give him a little arm twist to go the rest of the trip with him and introduce him. And Nile said, it was hard to turn down, but it would have been wrong. I'm not ready for politics at this point.
There was a Dr. Gotch in Shenandoah, Iowa, who wrote a letter to him saying that he thought that it might be politically unwise for him to throw all of his weight towards Wendell Willkie and alienate 50% of the people.
Dear Dr. Gotch, whether I lose 50% popular favor shall not deter me. My grandfather was a Republican governor of this state. He was honest, fearless, and competent. He lost many friends, but regained most of them, and in the end won the respect of all.
Kinnick was against American intervention in the war during FDR's first two terms in office. But as Nazi Germany threatened the stability of Europe, he reassessed his views.
I think if you look at the history of Iowa during those years, the Depression years, and early in, leading up to World War II, you had a great isolationist sentiment there. They still had a bad taste in their mouth from World War I. And let's face it, we have a big German population in the state of Iowa. It's not surprising to me that a young man like Nile Kinnick would grow up in that atmosphere and think that, no, we shouldn't be involved in World War II.
I can remember writing in a college theme that I was tired of hearing of nations' manifest destiny and of the inevitability of war, and that I would fight when I saw the tanks coming up Number 6 Highway, and not before. What an immature view.
He stopped in to see me and tell me that he was leaving and going into the service. And I remember saying to him, why don't you finish law school first? And he said, oh, Larry, I just feel that it's my responsibility for all of the people of this country to go into the service.
Joining the Navy, Kinnick reported for active duty just 3 days before the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941.
Every man whom I have admired in history has willingly and courageously served in his country's armed forces in times of danger. It is not only a duty, but an honor to follow their examples as best I know how. May God give me the courage and ability to so conduct myself in every situation that my country, my family, and my friends will be proud of me.
On June 2, 1943, Kinnick's plane experienced problems while practicing takeoffs and landings on the USS Lexington, somewhere near the Venezuelan coast.
So he had to make a choice of ditching in the Gulf of Paria, which was very smooth that day, or trying to land back on the deck. And there were several planes already positioned on the deck, and they weren't ready to receive planes.
If I had been flying that airplane and came in and I was having trouble, I just said, I'm landing, I don't care what's there, and landed. But that wasn't Nile.
If you were to think of a place that you would think of as an idyllic farm setting in a small community, it would be Adel. And my hometown of Cumming is about 20 miles from Adel. And so Nile Kinnick was always sort of a part of our folklore in Iowa as I was growing up.
Nile Clark Kinnick was born on July 9, 1918 in Adel, Iowa, to Nile Kinnick Sr. and Francis Clark, whose father had served as governor of the state from 1913 to 1917.
His grandfather sent him a rough copy of Longfellow's Excelsior, which is a poem about striving. Though the striver fails and dies, still the effort is worth it. Improve, get better, exceed. And he took those lessons to heart.
Kinnick's parents graduated first and second in their high school class of 1912. They married in 1916, and the additions of Ben and George rounded out the Kinnick family at five. It was at home where Nile developed physically and mentally under the guidance of his parents.
He was the landing deck from which the kids took off, and he was always there for them when they came back to land.
The Kinnicks were hauling shelled corn from one farm to another. They started throwing some shelled corn at cars they went by, and they happened to hit a convertible. Well, Mr. Kinnick got quite a talking to from this lady, and Nile and Ben were grounded for 2 weeks. They couldn't call anybody else. I couldn't call Ann. In fact, I couldn't even walk on their side of the street.
His mother was a Christian Science practitioner. People who come to them have great problems, often have very serious illnesses, spiritual or physical, and she adopted that role beautifully. And Nile relied on his mother greatly for helping him to adjust his Christian Science philosophy.
Fond of both his brothers, Nile developed a particularly strong tie with Ben, who was but a year younger.
Nile had teased his brother to the point where Benjamin was not going to stand for it any longer. Nile Jr. ran for the barn, and Benjamin had picked up a throwing rock, and he let it fly, and it got Nile right in the back of the head. And he carried that scar for the rest of his life. We called it his Heidelberg dueling scar.
George loved both Ben and Nile, I know that, but I think that he did feel like a second banana.
Dear George, you, as well as Ben and I, have a wonderful heritage from parents, grandparents, relations, associations, and religion. Make the most of all of them. You have much to live up to. I expect much of you in the years to come, and I am sure you will not fail.
While the Kinnicks fared better than most at the onset of the Depression, they were forced to sell their farms by 1933. The next year, Nile Sr. moved his family to Omaha, where he had found work for the Federal Land Bank.
Nile Jr. was along with him and another employee of the bank. They visited a farm. Farmer's name was Gus. And Gus looked up at his house and he said, "Could you spare me some shingles?" And Nile's father had to say, "We don't put shingles or any other improvements on property that we don't own." Then as they went out into the fields, Gus lowered the wire, the fence wire, for the other men to walk through. But then they ignored Gus and let him find his way over the fence as well as possible. Well, this offended Nile Jr.
And so thereafter, he would frequently address his father as the farmer's name, Gus, dear Gus, and just to remind his father of that occasion. I knew him. I grew up with him. I was closer to him than anybody else that we were with. There was nothing show-off about him. There was no bragging. He was just an ordinary fella that always did a good job.
Oh yeah, that's a first down.
Woo!
Way to read the D. Yeah. That's what I'm talking All about. Right.
Can't get enough football? Grab a Miller Lite and anytime is Miller time.
Who's calling these plays?
Put in a backup!
The Super Bowl's coming. Make room for Miller Lite inflatable chairs. Enter to win them wherever you buy Miller Lite or at SuperBowl.com.
Guys, there's a couch just like mine downstairs.
Gilman, Houdini's of the hardwood. And now they're playing the first live game in the history of ESPN Classic. It's the Harlem Globetrotters 75th anniversary game. Join basketball's greatest ambassadors at the site of their first ever road game to celebrate 75 years of fun, laughs, and classic hoops. The Harlem Globetrotters 75th Anniversary Game Live, Sunday starting at noon with a live game at 2 only on ESPN Classic.
Nile loved sports. He was a pitcher in baseball, and then he transitioned into being a catcher, and he caught to Bob Feller.
Played American Legion baseball when I was up there at Adel for 2 years. He caught some. He's about a year older than I was 12 when I first played up in Adel.
As a former quarterback at Iowa State, Nile's father encouraged all of his boys to participate in sports. Nile did more than just play. He wasn't content until he understood every nuance of the sport.
I talked with Otto Kohl. Otto started coaching with Nile, when Nile was in sixth grade. He relied on Nile. He said Nile understood the game perfectly. By the time he reached high school, he knew as much as the coach did. He was called the coach on the field.
Kinnick led the Adel Junior High football team to an undefeated season in 1930, shutting out all opponents. 3 years later, he was leading Adel High to its first undefeated season.
In 1933, we met for the final game of the season out at Adel, and both of us were undefeated up to that time. People gathered from all of the central part of Iowa, so that there were an estimated 6,000 to 7,000 people at that football game. The game actually ended 20-20.
Saturday morning, all of us guys would have to go over to the Kinnicks and have Nile run through the game again for us, tell us about certain plays that he did, and we'd sit there and watch him eat his oatmeal. I remember seeing raisins in this oatmeal. Well, boy, that triggered me. From then on, I always had raisins in my oatmeal.
As a forward on the basketball team, Kinnick scored over 1,000 points in 3 years. In his junior season, he scored more than a third of his team's points.
When I saw Nile Kinnick on the basketball court, it was unbelievable. Unbelievable. I'd never, ever in my life, nor did anyone else, seen anybody could handle the ball the way he could. He was just outstanding. The next time I saw him, I was playing against him. I had an inkling of it. He was a good football player, and he had moved to Omaha and played at Omaha Benson. He carried the ball directly into the line, off tackle, and he hit just like a stone wall. He stopped him, dead still. He spun off of that thing, that little pile up there, and as quick as could be, he was gone for a touchdown right around my end. And they beat us 7-0. That's the first two times that I'd seen Nile Kinnick.
Kinnick was just as impressive in the classroom, graduating with an A average. But he drew a failing grade from the coach of Minnesota, the three-time national champions of the 30s.
When Nile tried out, Bernie Bierman tested his speed and looked him over. And although he was a very tough 5'8", about 175 pounds, he wasn't extremely fast. And so Bernie Bierman wrote to Nile's coach, and he said, he's too small and he's too slow.
I've been very fortunate with people. They're advertised as too small, too slow, not strong enough, not fast enough, whatever, and had great results with them because they had what I call an extra heartbeat, and that's what Nile Kinnick had. He was determined to be the best player on the field.
That was, I think, his impetus to go to the University of Iowa and try out there. And of course, he was so well known in Iowa because of his high school career that he had little trouble being accepted there, given a scholarship.
If every high school player recruited today happened to be a Nile Kinnick, you could cut scholarships by a half. He could run, he could pass, he could kick off returns, punt returns, punts. He did everything.
Before enrolling as a freshman, Kinnick and his brother Ben loaded up the family's 29 Ford and took off on a summer adventure out west.
They went out to Colorado, and then they went up to Seattle. One of the interesting parts of that trip was Nile and Ben climbed Long's Peak, which is 14,652 feet high. That was Nile's best memory of that trip, was conquering Long's Peak, which might give you an insight into his character.
When Kinnick arrived on campus in 1936, he found the Iowa Athletic Department in shambles. The Hawkeyes were the doormat of the Big Ten.
The stadium here was built, the stadium we still play in was built in 1929. They hadn't paid off the bond issue on the stadium.
My dad had a couple of bonds on the Iowa stadium, and I can remember him telling me in the middle 1930s that, hey, you might as well put these up on the wall to cover a crack because they're not worth the paper they're written on. The athletic department was basically broke.
Despite Iowa's 1-7 record, Kinnick was selected first team All-Big Ten as a sophomore. On the scholastic front, Kinnick was in the top 10% of his class and served as a residence hall proctor.
He even knew sign language. We got on the train one time to go into Chicago, and there were two cars of deaf and dumb kids. And somebody looks around for Nile, and, well, he's back there with these kids. He's talking to them. I said, how can he be talking to them? Went back there, and he is doing the sign language. He had memorized that. The guy was unbelievable.
An ankle injury in the opening game of 1938 hobbled Kinnick for the remainder of the season. A Christian Scientist by faith, he refused medical treatment.
In my opinion, Nile was playing with a cracked bone in his ankle.
He wouldn't let you know if he was hurt. He was under the impression that he could get well through his work with God.
Dear Mother, as far as I'm concerned, neither Iowa nor Nile Kinnick has been whipped by error yet, nor will they be. I'm grateful that there has been little publicity of my injury. Help me handle the belief that the Iowa team and spirit is dependent on my being able to go at top speed.
In 1938, Iowa scored only 46 points for the year.
Being only human, he probably was discouraged, but whenever Nile was defeated, he just tried harder, and he became a fighter. And as Governor Clark said in a note to him once, see, if they knock you down, come back and stick your chin out and come back for more.
Dear family, there is, without a doubt, a strong movement to get a Notre Dame man in here. What the actual outcome will be is pretty much beyond prediction. Whether you should want me to play for an ND man, I do not know.
When head coach Earl Tubbs left Iowa after the 1938 season, rumors swirled that former Notre Dame star Eddie Anderson was being considered. As Christian Scientists, the Kinnicks were reluctant to have a Catholic as a coach.
When they made a coaching change here, she became displeased. It's quite evident to me that this bias on their part did exist.
There was some concern, I think, certainly not on my father's side, but my father was a very religious Roman Catholic, and Nile was a very religious Christian Scientist. And here was two people that actually, once they met, and got together and saw what each one of them brought to the table as far as football goes, they had a bond.
Nile and Anderson walked off the field. Anderson had his arms around him every night, which sometimes made me kind of jealous.
It did smack a little of favoritism. My father would call the rest of them by their last name, but Nile was Nile.
Well, Eddie had been an All-American end at Notre Dame under Ruckney. He brought the Notre Dame, the Ruckney way of doing things to this team.
Anderson's grueling spring practices left an already talent-poor team even more depleted.
We didn't scrimmage much because we didn't have a big enough squad. We started out with 87 in the spring, and we ended up with about 37 in the fall.
The 1939 Hawkeyes opened the season by thrashing South Dakota 41-0 before a sparse home crowd. Indiana was next, and Iowa trailed 29-26 late in the fourth quarter.
Here was Nile. He'd been saying, we can still do this. He moved us down the field and hit Irwin Prassy with a beautiful pass. We won the game 32-29. That was a lifter like you've never seen.
That kind of set the tone in my mind. We all felt we're going to do something this year. So we go to Michigan the next weekend.
Well, that's a great moment to remember because we had Tom Harmon pitted against Nile Kinnick. And they came in undefeated.
Tom Harmon ended up winning the game. He had three touchdowns.
Iowa just had a dearth of material, and we didn't think that they could last throughout the season.
The Hawkeyes bounced back from the Michigan loss by beating Wisconsin, with Kinnick leading them to another come-from-behind victory. In the next week's win over Purdue, the nation was taking notice of the Corn Belt Comet.
You don't see very many people can play 60 minutes at a high level, and he could maintain that better than anybody I'd ever seen.
He was just about the strongest, toughest little guy you ever saw. Unbelievable. The hits he took, and he bounced right up like a rubber ball and huddled up.
Nile Kinnick was the Iowa team. He ran, he passed, he punted, he place kicked, and also he was a great defensive ball player. He never made a mistake.
Kinnick was the nation's fourth leading rusher when Iowa met Notre Dame before 50,000 at home. In a scoreless game in the second quarter, Iowa had the ball deep in Irish territory.
I'll always remember when he went the last 4 yards against Notre Dame. I've seen it on film I don't know how many times. It's a great picture. Kinnick drops his shoulder and bounces off and into the end zone. That's my lasting image of him.
Late in the game, with Iowa holding on 7-6 against Notre Dame, everyone was scared to death this isn't going to last.
And we have to punt. Nile gets off about a 60, 65-yarder, a line drive, and that ball absolutely hit on about the 4 or 5-yard line. You could see the puff of line come up.
In the Notre Dame game, he not only scored the winning touchdown and kicked the point, but he batted down 2 passes in the last quarter.
Movies had newsreel clips of football games throughout the country. No one had ever heard of Iowa, but all of a sudden in theaters from Texas to New York to Georgia to Alabama, people stood up and cheered when they heard the Iowa score beating Notre Dame. And then came Minnesota, which Iowa hadn't beaten in a decade, and we hated them.
Strongest team in the country, 4 years in a row. Bernie Bierman was the coach then at Minnesota, and he was a tough cookie, too. Going into the fourth quarter, they had us 9-0. The coupe call, the play where Evans and I crisscrossed deep, and I'm waiting for the ball to come down. That was the first touchdown. Now it's coming down to about the last 2-3 minutes of the ball game, and finally we get within striking distance, and Bill Green goes right up the middle.
I was going to run out of the end zone, but he laid it right in my arms. But I went into the crowd. It was a mob.
They had a real good view of it when Kinnick threw a long pass to Bill Green. Iowa won 13-9, and the fans went crazy again.
Probably 20,000 or more stormed the field to congratulate the players.
I can remember standing by the runway where the Minnesota players were going back to the dressing room. And Bierman walked by me, and I can see this look to this very day. The look on his face is a wonder it didn't crack the bricks in the stadium.
The Big Ten title would belong to the Hawkeyes if they could beat Northwestern the following week. But it wasn't to be. Kinnick left the game with a separated shoulder as Iowa struggled to a 7-7 tie.
When I read what they accomplished and how Iowa had been so bad for such a long time, just as I'm doing now, I can cry about it. And that's kind of strange. 60 years ago, and that's how I feel about it.
After setting 14 school records, Kinnick was awarded the Heisman Trophy. Ever mindful of a world at war, his acceptance speech remains one of the most moving in the history of the award.
I would like, if I may, to make a comment which I think is appropriate at this time. I thank God that I was born to the gridirons of the Middle West and not to the battlefields of Europe. I can say confidently and positively that the football players of this country would much rather fight for the Heisman Award than for the Croix de Guerre.
I think it was probably the most dynamic and expressive speech that anybody could make. We were very proud that he won it and glad that he won it.
And when they came home after winning, that trophy. Some of the people that had automobile agencies were down there with their new cars to give him a ride home. And he said, no, he said, Dean brought me down, I'm going to ride home with him. It was quite a celebration for a little town to have somebody win the Heisman.
Is your dandruff sending the wrong signals?
Get the screen now, and you'll receive your commemorative coin for only $5, no shipping and handling charge at all. Because this coin is issued to honor the brave soldiers of Gettysburg, only 3 coins are available per caller.
Order the Civil War coin for just $5. Pay no shipping or handling. Have your credit card ready and call 1-800-538-0550 or send check or money order for $5 to the address on your screen. Call now 1-800-538-0550, 1-800-538-0550.
It's here. Inside is unlimited strength and power. This is Bowflex, an entire gym in one easy-to-use machine. So powerful, it delivers over 60 health club quality exercises with up to 410 pounds of resistance, all in the convenience of your own home. For a free video and brochure, call or go online at bowflexdirect.com. Bowflex. Who said change is easy?
When Sports Century continues, Nile Kinnick looks toward a future in politics. If only he lives long enough to see America in peacetime.
My lasting memory of Nile was when he came back to the University of Iowa as a commissioned officer. Nile Kinnick showed up in his Navy uniform. He looked like General Eisenhower.
His example in going into the Naval Air Corps and being a poster boy for them was symbolic to me. And I formed the Flying Hawkeyes. I think we had 30 Flying Hawkeyes that we went through in Naval Air training, and that was because of Nile.
As his naval training took him through the Deep South, Kinnick was appalled by an atmosphere thick with social injustice.
A relative saw him in the South during the war as a bus was loading, and she noticed that the blacks went to the back of the bus, and she looked at Kinnick and saw how sad he looked, dismayed. He hadn't apparently seen that before.
We supposedly are fighting this war to obliterate the malignant idea of racial supremacy and master-slave relationships. When this war is over, the color problem is apt to be more difficult than ever. May wisdom, justice, and brotherly love guide our steps to the right solution.
He couldn't get over the way the blacks were being treated. I look back at the things I was thinking of at that time and the things that he was. He had a mind of a 40-year-old person.
What appealed to him was his thought of becoming a politician, a person in public life, and in particular, a senator.
Dear Gus, I wish you would cagily and unobtrusively sound the political opinion of the men and women in different areas with whom you come in contact. Nationally, try to determine what are their convictions and hopes for the post-war world. Would suggest you give no indication of your son's possible intentions.
And it's interesting that he thought of sounding out views about him in other states. Now, for that, you're thinking of national office. What else is there but president?
On the morning of June 2, 1943, the Lexington was on a training assignment in the Caribbean. Kinnick and his fellow aviators were practicing maneuvers in preparation for joining the Pacific Fleet.
He was going through a new experience of learning to fly a little F-4F a fighter plane. I never got the idea that he felt he had really mastered flying the airplane.
Nile was a leader in a section of planes, and he would be one of the first ones off after he's in the air at a rendezvous. And during this time, he had developed some low oil pressure.
The engine simply locked, and he had to go down.
And he'd called back to the carrier and told him that he wasn't going to be able to hold out.
With several planes on deck, a landing was, at best, a reckless option.
He told the commander of the air group that he was planning to ditch in the ocean.
The landing was okay in the water.
And Bill Reiter said that he saw Nile crawl out of the plane and that he was lying in the water and he seemed dazed.
And Bill went to the ship to report this, and it seems to me that Nile waved.
So there was hopes that he would survive, but apparently he did go down with the plane.
Rescue parties searched for Kinnick for over an hour, but no sign of his body or the wreckage was found. News of his death shocked the nation and paralyzed the state of Iowa.
It was like losing a member of your family. Couldn't believe it.
Just thinking about it now, it's just devastating to me.
There was just a general period of about 2 weeks in which there was just total mourning of the entire student body, professors, and everybody because of Nile's death.
His father wrote to Benjamin. He said, tonight the stars will not shine as brightly as they did before, but they will still shine.
15 months later, Kinnick's brother Ben was shot down and killed in the Pacific while on a bombing mission. Through it all, the Kinnicks carried on, never questioning fate.
They had stoic blood in them. I mean, they felt it, and you knew that they were suffering, but it would never show.
You had that feeling of so much is lost for nothing. Great future, lost in a blink of an eye.
The people that knew him and the people that came up through that era are the ones that say, golly, if he could just have lived.
It was going to be awfully hard to satisfy him, but he loved commitment, and he loved a commitment that dealt with the truth. And so that meant seeking really almost the impossible.
And here was a guy who was a Phi Beta Kappa, a campus leader, a Heisman Trophy winner, and he just captivated the hearts and souls of the entire state of Iowa like I've never seen before. The only thing I can compare it to now, in retrospect, was really the same kind of an aura of a John F. Kennedy. Great charisma, great magnetism.
I've often wondered what might have happened should Kinnick have survived and been successful in politics, becoming a U.S. Senator from Iowa, how he might have entered the 1960 election. Kennedy was born in 1917, Kinnick in 1918. They were both intelligent, ambitious people, both very articulate, both very attractive, both from the Navy.
His record and his intellectual capacity, his grit, determination. I think he could have been president of the United States. I really do.
For decades, Nile Sr. resisted memorializing his son, not wanting to single him out among the more than 400,000 Americans lost in the war. Finally, he consented, and in 1972, the University of Iowa dedicated its football stadium to the memory of his late son.
He expected other people to be as fair in life and fair with other people as he was, and he thought it was ordinary. He didn't think that he was an exceptional individual.
Well, I think he should be remembered as just a great American, one that gave his life for his country. He was an outstanding student and a very good athlete and a very good friend.
I was pretty much in awe of him. As far as I'm concerned, everything with Nile was perfect. His death was a great loss to the people of Iowa and I think actually the United States.
In all of us, there's a sense of what might be, what's possible. And I think the legacy of Nile Kinnick is anything's possible. No matter where you're from, you can make it. You can do great things. Even though he had a very brief life, he can still motivate people, especially motivate young people.